Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from one of our special guests.
Before you're seated, if you take your Bible, please. We stand to read the Word of God. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 6 to 8. Therefore, I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God. Let's pray. Father, today we thank you that we're in this marvelous church with all these wonderful people. We pray today that your word will come forth correctly and find a lodging place in our hearts. Challenge us, change us. May people come to know you today. In Jesus' name, and everybody shouted, amen. Amen. You may be seated. I want to talk to you today on this subject. Live strong. Everybody shout out real loud, please. Live strong.
Live strong.
Shout it again, please.
Live strong.
I learned a long time ago that survival is not necessarily a sign of success. Can be, but not necessarily. Some things have lasted a long time that were not successful. In order to be successful, we need to be intentional. Let me say that again. In order to be successful, we need to be intentional. We get what we aim at. If you're aiming at nothing, looking for nothing, believing for nothing, you'll get nothing. The DNA of a local church such as this is incredibly important, for that's what it will be years down the road. Kathy and I were invited to preach at a missions conference in Suva, Fiji, earlier in the year. Church is called Christian Missionary Fellowship. The pastor is Pastor Suliasi. I'd heard about him. And in various places we'd gone around the world, people would ask if we were aware of him. We discovered him to be the kindest and most passionate man that we just about have ever met. 25 years ago, it was their 25th anniversary, they started the church with a vision to reach their city, country and world, and they have never ever deviated from that. Part of their DNA is they believe nothing is too hard for God. Wow. I discovered they had a building. Now you listen to this. We're not talking Los Angeles, New York, Sydney. We're talking about Suva, Fiji, a third world country that's had several coups. A building that seats 3,500 people. paid for. They have over 6,000 members. More than that attend. They have planted churches in almost 200 nations. They've actually planted churches here in the U.S. They have over 5,000 churches. Blew me away. They own their own FM radio station, paid for. Own their own TV station that reaches Suva, 800,000 people, paid for. The Saturday we were there, they opened their own supermarket, paid for. The best supermarket in Suva, prices were way cheaper than any other supermarket. And the first day they opened at 8, supposed to close at 6, and because of the crowds, they couldn't close until 10 o'clock that night. Happened all that week like that. And Pastor Suliasi said this statement in one of his messages. It got a hold of me, this. We don't have missions because we have a church. We have a church because we have missions. Whoa. That's awesome. That's awesome. Let me say that again. He said it, not me. I'm not smart enough to make that up. We don't have missions because we have a church. We have a church because we have missions. The mission is the what that drives us. The mission is the why we do what we do. People that know why will always lead people who know what. A lot of people know what to do, but they do not know why they are doing it. If you don't have the why, you will lack the motivation to do what you need to do. You may have feeling and enthusiasm, but you need more than that. In fact, one of the nights I preached there, as we came in, we discovered there was as many people outside the building that could not get into the building. And they had to put up speakers everywhere. And I asked Pastor Suliasi, I said, do you want me to give an altar call for people to get saved? I know it's a missions conference. And he said, I want you to do two things. I want you to do what God wants you to do, and I want you to do what you do best. I gave an altar call in a missions conference, and over 400 first-time decisions for Christ. Come on, hallelujah. That's awesome. That's God. In Matthew 28, verses 18 to 20, talks about going into the world, reaching people and making disciples of all cultures. And he said, I give you the authority to do that. That means all of God's authority on heaven and earth is behind us when we reach out to win people to Jesus. Come on, are you hearing me? That's what goes on in this house. Now, that word authority is an interesting word. It actually means I authorize you. So when you go out and you talk to somebody about Jesus, whether it be at home, at work, at school, in business, in church, whatever it may be, he authorizes us to do it. Hallelujah. That means the authority of heaven is behind us. This reading, these verses, Matthew 28, is commonly called the Great Commission. If you break the word commission up, it means co-mission. God has always tied himself to human cooperation for the execution of divine purposes. If heaven is going to accomplish its purposes, it has to have someone or some people to work through. And that's you and I. There has to be human representation in order to accomplish what God desires to do. In my early days, I thought everything was God. And then I discovered it's not that way. There's always a cooperation between God and the believer and the believer and God. God says, I will go with you. But he did not say, I will do it for you. We're not talking about the miraculous. If the will of God is going to be done at home, at work, at school, business, church, city to the nations, he needs someone who will stand up and say, I'll be one of those people who does the will of God and fulfills the purposes of God in my generation. When I got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit, God put something in me. And I wanted to change our cities, our states, our nations around the world. I actually believe that we can change our nation for the good. I don't care what politicians say. I don't care what's coming down the pike. God is bigger than that. Everywhere we go, we need to tell the gospel story. And if we do, understand that we've been authorized to do it. Romans chapter 1 verse 8 says, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. We need to reach every sphere and every ethnic group. You, like me, have been saved. And I believe the enemy recognizes he will never be able to take us back to our previous lifestyle of sin. On my worst day, I'm not going back there. Come on, hallelujah. I refuse to go back there. And I know you do too. But what the enemy will try to do is intimidate us, shut us up, shut us down. He will try to make us feel timid, insecure, inadequate. There is nothing that causes a believer to become less threatening for the kingdom of God than a believer who becomes intimidated and fearful. Paul the Apostle wrote two letters to Timothy. The first letter, Paul is in prison, first time in prison in Rome. He was under house arrest. He expected to be released, to go on out and further the preaching of the gospel and the establishing of churches in the then known world. Paul encourages in the first letter to Timothy to fight the fight of faith. In other words, don't give up, don't back down, don't quit, keep going forward. Come on, hallelujah. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 2, Paul refers to Timothy as his son in the faith. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 8, he tells Timothy, war a good warfare by the prophecies that were given over you. Timothy was a young man who had the fire of God in him, burning in him. And Paul made him the senior pastor of the church at Ephesus, which was the largest known church in the world at that time. The scholars say somewhere between 20 and 30,000 believers. He was told to teach and train, keep the people from fables and wrong doctrine. Then in the second letter to Timothy, there's four things, and there's quite a difference. Paul is now incarcerated again in the worst hellhole of prisons that there was, and he knows that he's not going to get out, and he's going to die there. The first thing he tells Timothy in the second letter, in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5, he reminds him of his legacy in faith. He says, the faith that is in you was in your mother Eunice and in your grandmother Lois. Listen to me. You and I are not just filling a seat in a church. We are creating and developing legacy. Come on, hallelujah. In your sons and daughters, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren, they will follow your legacy. Kathy and I were visiting our daughter. She's got three kids, and our 13-year-old daughter has just gone into high school. And she said to me, Poppy, that's what she calls me. She said, I told the teacher, you are the greatest preacher there's ever been. Probably not true, but I'm glad she thinks so. That's called legacy. Come on, are you hearing me? Yeah. Her brother, who was 11 and was chosen for an all-star team in a sporting thing, and he broke his finger. And he wasn't going to be able to play in these games. And he said to his mother, I'm going to call Poppy. I'm going to get him to pray for me. She said, that's good. He goes, yeah, he's pretty good at pulling these miracles out. She said, wait a minute, he doesn't do them, God does them. I know, I know. And he got healed. But it's called legacy. Come on, are you hearing me? You and I are leaving a legacy of faith. The word faith was genuine faith. Not plastic, not whipped up, genuine faith. And it was in Timothy. The kingdom of God never dies when a generation dies. The kingdom of God has always been generational. I am here. Kathy is here. You are here. This church is here. These pastors are here because we were able to climb up on the shoulders of somebody else that came before us that established the legacy. Number two. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 6. He says to Timothy, stir up the gift of God which is in you by the laying on of my hands. I used to wonder, why is Paul telling him these things? We'll get to that in a minute. God has deposited something in you and I for this generation. But sometimes we need to stir it up. The word stir in the Greek means kindle like a fire, like making a fire. Blow on it, fan it. We have to stir it up. It's not God's responsibility to stir up what is in us. It is our responsibility. Of course, he will help. Fire's natural tendency ultimately is to go out. There was a time when I got dry, and it was time for me to stir up the fire. I wasn't backslidden. I wasn't away from God, and neither are you. And God told me to go somewhere. And I said, why can't you do it here? And he simply said, the wise men went to where Jesus was. Wow. And it got stirred up again. There's various things that happen in our lives that cause us to pull back a little bit. You don't have to pull back much for there to be a difference. I don't mean you don't love God. I don't mean you're backslidden. I say that again. You're not. Age can be one. Sometimes when we get a little older, we sort of settle down. Well, let the young people do it. Or whatever. I said to God, I'm older now. As if he didn't know. I said, during the worship, I'll just sit down. I don't need to raise my hands anymore. He said, you can spend 4 hours walking around a golf course. Why can't you spend 30 minutes worshiping me? Standing up and raising your hands. Whoops, he won again. Come on, are you hearing me? Stir up the gift that's in you. If your dreams won't get you out of bed every day, they're not going to get anyone else up. That's a little blunt. That's kind of Australian. What's inside of us has to be stirred up. It's time for us to say, this is my day, this is my opportunity to be whom God called me to be. And age has nothing to do with it. It doesn't matter how old we are or how young we are. Stop worrying about what you don't have and stir up what you do have. I would always like to be a soloist, a worship leader. Nobody else wants me to be it. And there's a vital reason why. You wouldn't want me singing. They asked me in the back room, did you ever play an instrument? I said, yes. I learned the trumpet until the trumpet teacher took it away from me and threw it at me. I got the message. So why would I try to stir that up when I don't have that gift? I was watching the guys singing here and the gentleman on the keyboard, and I went, dear God, they're almost as good as I am. In my dreams. Stir up what you have. Number three. This is where we really get to what Paul was saying. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. God has not given you the spirit of fear. The word fear there in the Greek is the word timidity. It's also the word cowardice. Timidity brings low self-esteem. God did not call us to be timid or cowardly. We're not to be intimidated. What that means is you've just pulled back a little bit. Live strong. Live strong. Let me say it a third time. Live strong. Do you know that 63 times in the Bible, it says words like this, God will never leave you nor forsake you. Things that cause us to pull back can be age. Sicknesses, pains, diseases, hurts and wounds, criticism by other people, negative reactions. Don't allow anything to cause you to become timid and pull back. That That's easy to do. You got to stand up, put your shoulders back, and your head up high and say, I'm a child of the living God, and I've got a gift in me to reach this generation. All stuff happens. A guy came to me not too long ago and he said, I've never had anything go wrong in my Christian life. Then I said, you ain't done nothing. Devil doesn't have to worry about you. There's not one of us that haven't had something happen that might have caused us to pull back a little. Hey, the biggest ship that was ever made on its maiden voyage sunk. It was called the Titanic. But they didn't stop building ships. In fact, they built them bigger, better, and safer. Come on, hallelujah. Airplanes have crashed, but it didn't stop the manufacturers of airplanes from building bigger planes, better planes, safer planes. Automobile manufacturers. Most of them at one stage or another have built what they called a lemon. If you don't know what that is, thank God. But it didn't stop them building bigger, better, safer, more productive automobiles. See, anybody can give up, anybody can quit, anybody can pull back. It takes no faith and no effort. He is with us everywhere we go. Come on, hallelujah. And Paul goes on to tell Timothy, he's given you the spirit of power. That's the Greek word dunamis. Anything that gets in your way, you can blow it out of the way because you're not powerless, you are powerful. Then he gave you a spirit of love. Love is a force against fear and timidity. 1 John 4:18 says, perfect love casts out fear or timidity. See, fear overtakes our thinking and controls us. Then he said, not only have I given you power and love, I've given you a sound mind. You've got the mind of Christ living and abiding and residing within you. The enemy wants to push us back into just maintaining. But Paul is saying to Timothy, don't say it isn't working because I'm in prison. And number 4, 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 8. Timothy, even though I'm in prison, even though I'm going to die, even though you're probably not going to see me again, don't be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of what has happened to me. That's why he was pulling back. That's why the gift wasn't operating like it should. That's why he had moved away from this faith. We have allowed at times situations that are not nice to affect us. Don't feel like the Lone Ranger. happened to all of us. And Paul's final word to Timothy was this, verse 13. Hold fast. In other words, Timothy, do all that I've told you to do. Hold fast. Don't quit. Don't give up. Don't back away. Don't be timid. Press forward. And watch what I'll do. My dear friends here today, it is time to stop pulling back, and it's time to start living strong. What Paul said to Timothy, God is saying to you and I, remember the faith that's already in you. Stir up, fan the flame of the fire that once burned bright in you. God has not given us the spirit of fear or timidity or even cowardice, but a spirit of love, power, and a sound mind. Yeah. Don't be ashamed. Hold on fast. That means hold on tight. And press forward. Come on, hallelujah. A few preachers said to Kathy and I close with this. We had 3 years where we went through hell on earth. I'm sure it affected some of our decisions. And I had preachers actually say to me, if I had to go through what you went through, I'd quit preaching and I wouldn't serve God. See, you don't understand. Firstly, we don't serve God, we love God. Come on, hallelujah. That makes the difference. Come on, are you hearing me? That makes the difference. And the second thing is this, we're in for the long haul. And if stuff happens, we're not quitting, we're not giving up, we're not backing down, we're going forward, we're going on, hallelujah. I said I'd close with that, but I lied. I want to tell you this. Last week up in San Jose where we were, a couple who live in Sacramento came to visit Kathy and I. He used to be the youth pastor several years ago of the largest youth group in the United States, 5,000 young people. Most churches are not that big. When they went on a youth outing, hundreds of buses. And unfortunately, the pastor fell. I'd never heard of him. I didn't know anything about him. Didn't even recognize the name. One day I'm praying, and God gives me a name right in front of me. Said, I want you to help him. Had no idea who it was. I couldn't even pronounce the second name. So I called a friend of mine on the East Coast who's a prophet. I mean, not a wannabe, a real one. I said, God gave me this name, and I don't know how to pronounce their surname, but I'll spell it to you. He said, are you serious? Of course I'm serious. I wouldn't tell you if I wasn't. I said, God told me to help him. He said, I met him for the first time 30 minutes ago. He was in my office right here. He left 5 minutes ago. He said, I'll see if I can catch him. He looks out the window. He said, no, there's no way. I see his car going down the highway. He's just gone through the lights. But here's his home phone number. You call and leave a message because he's not there and tell him I gave it to you. I left the message. The next day I get a phone call. I told him what had happened. Him and his wife came to visit us. Ultimately moved to our church. And we helped them. Or at least we tried to help them. They came up from Sacramento last week. And they said to Kathy and I, we're writing a book, it's nearly finished, about our life. And we're including the sin that was committed. Most people try to hide it. And we've got a chapter about you guys because if you hadn't have come to us, I don't know what would have happened. You saved us. Later that day, I got a text from him. And in the text, he simply said this. After all these years at your age, my wife and I can still see the fire burning in your eyes. Don't ever lose it. I have preachers say to me, when I get to a certain age, I can't wait to quit. I say, when I get to that age, I'm going to start again. Come on, hallelujah. I'm going to stir it up. I'm going to remember the faith. I'm not going to be timid, and I'm not going to be ashamed. Everybody stand, please. I want you to shout at the top of your voice, please. Live strong. Ladies, will you shout at one time, please? Men, will you shout at one time, please? Everybody, for the last time, would you shout it together? You may be seated. Come on. Let every head be bowed, every eye closed. Nobody moving around unless you absolutely have to. Nobody talking, nobody looking. Just for a couple of minutes. Today, I would like to have the honor of praying for the greatest miracle that can happen to a human being. That is the miracle of Jesus coming into your heart and life and washing all of your sin away. You say, what are you talking about? Here's what I'm talking about. Every human being, you, me, and everyone else, was born into this world with an inherent nature of sin. But God said, I'm not going to leave you like that. I will make a way out, a way of escape for you. And so his son Jesus went to the cross, and on the cross he took the sin of all mankind upon himself. And he said, if you'll open up your heart, your mind, and invite me in, I will come in spiritually, and I will wash away all of your sin. So at that moment, you will be as if you've never, ever sinned. You have to make a choice. You have to make a decision. At this point, people start making excuses within themselves not to do it. They say things like this, I don't want to be religious. We don't want you to be religious either. Giving your life to God is not being religious, it's about relationship. So, well, I've got my church. We're not talking about your church, whether it be this one or somewhere else. We're talking about Jesus coming into your life. So, well, I'm cool, man. All my family's always gone to church, so I'm okay. No, you're not. Nobody can make this choice for you. You have to make it for yourself. Well, you say, what will everybody think about me? If you live your life based on what people think about you, you're in a tragic way. So, well, I'll go home and think about it. That's just a very nice way of saying no. And so this morning, I want to pray for men and women, young people. Doesn't matter if you're visiting for the first time, been here two or three times before, or even become a regular attender, say, Al, I don't know for sure that all my sin is washed away. I don't know for sure that I belong to God and God's connected to me. And I want you to pray for me for that to happen. In order for me to pray for you, I'm going to ask you to respond very simply. Right across this auditorium, up in the rooms on the side, in order for me to pray for you, I'm going to ask you to do what they did in the early service and yesterday morning, is simply raise your hand, hold it up, let me see it, and then put it down. Just hold it up right now. Put your hand up. His hand's starting to go up. Put it up high so I can count. There's one. There's two. There's three. There's four. I'm over on my right. Okay, coming across. There's five. There's six. Seven. Amen. You may put your hands down. Anybody else right now? Up the back there. God bless you. Anybody else? You haven't raised your hand. The Spirit of God is speaking to you right now. This is your moment. This is your opportunity. Down here, God bless you. Just raise your hand if you haven't already done it. Just put it up high. Yeah, yeah, God bless you. Yeah, God bless you. Anybody else, quickly raise your hand. All right, let's all just stand together. I want you to listen to me, and then I'm going to ask you to do what I'm going to ask you to do. If you raised your hand, and even if you didn't, in a moment I'm going to ask you to step out of your seat, push past the people, walk down the aisles, stand in a line across the front facing me so we can pray for you. You say, do I need to come down there? If it was worth raising your hand, it's worth coming down here. Jesus went all the way to the cross for you and I to set us free. The Bible is very clear. If we confess Jesus publicly, he'll confess us before his heavenly Father. And finally, we're not against you, we're for you, we love you. If you need somebody to come with you, just grab somebody and say, come with me. If you brought somebody this morning, whether they raised their hand or not, just politely ask them to come and receive Jesus and come with them. Right now, everybody that raised your hand over here, down here, up here, over here, over here, over here, I'm going to ask you to step out of your seats right now. Press past the people, walk down the aisles and stand across the aisle, the front here facing me. Come right now. Come right now.
Your love never fails.
That's it. Come on. Come on.
Never runs.
Here they come. Here they come.
Your love never fails.
Don't wait. Don't stay back there. Come now.
Never runs out.
God love you. God love you.
Your love never fails.
This is your day. This is your opportunity. Come on up to the front. God bless you. God bless you.
All I need is found.
God bless you. God bless you.
And all I need is found in you.
God love you.
And all I need is found in
you. There's some more. God bless you. God bless you. Here's some more coming. God bless you. God love you. Come on over here, dear.
All I
Come on over here.
Found
That's it.
In
Here's some
All
more. God bless you. God bless you.
Oh, all I need is found in you.
Wow. God is awesome. We're delighted that you've come this morning to receive Jesus into your life and have all your sin washed away. I remember vividly, for me it was a night, Sunday night, where I got saved. And look how I turned out. What we're going to do, come on up here, Pastor. This pastor is a wonderful man. And we're going to ask you to go with him. And he's going to lead you into the side room just over here. Some others that are standing behind you are going to go with you. They're going to pray with you. They're going to give you some literature, because this is not the end of the journey. This is the beginning of a lifelong adventure. And then they will get you to fill out a decision card. And I would encourage you to get back into church next week. The devil doesn't want you in church, but God does. All right? So would you turn? Don't go back to your seats. Follow him out here right now. Give him a big hand as they go. That's it. Come on, give him.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me. And then he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven, as well as upon the earth, that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.